I am Florence Skrevzeles, Chief Rep for Americas. We have the pleasure to welcome you after our previous event on 23rd of March on central digital currency. Today, we will focus on crypto assets. What will shape the future of those digital assets? We aim to share Banque de France's views on that subject and offer an exchange of perspectives across the Atlantic. Please to enjoy fully this seminar, maintain for the time being your mic and camera on off. Our seminar is organized around two panel discussions. One is about crypto assets, risk and regulation, and the second addresses the question of what will become a standard. For those panels, let me introduce you our moderator, Fidel Middleton. He is chairman of the Digital Monetary Institute of ANFIF, forum and think tank well known to central bankers and official monetary institutions. Philip joined ANFIF 5 years ago and is currently a non-executive director of this forum. He is also a director of Raffles House Capital and a commissioner at the Guernsey Financial Service Commission.
Great welcome to everybody to this second in the series of global seminars, very kindly hosted and organized by the Banque de France. I have to say it's all happening since our last session on CBDC, central bank digital currencies. We're now moving on to looking at crypto assets, by which, for the purposes of today, we are staying away from fiat currency, central bank digital currency. We're staying away from commercial money, unless we feel a real urgent need to go there. And we are focusing on what we're calling crypto assets, and I'm not going to prescribe to our experts today what classifies as a crypto asset. Indeed, one of my questions will be, so what are these things and how should we recognize it? I would simply draw attention to the BIS research from last week that comes out very, very strongly in favor of regulating these things very, very strongly. The work and discussion paper put out by the Bank of England last week, which again broadly advances the view that these things may be acceptable provided they meet a whole range of standards of governance, functionality, regulation, supervision. There's some research actually that came out this morning on cryptos that suggested that asset managers on average were looking to hold about 7% of diversified portfolios in cryptos. Although, as one of my mentors pointed out, if things are on average, if your head's in the oven and your feet are in the fridge, on average you feel warm and comfortable. So that's enough from me. We have two panels today. The first one, we're going to look at crypto assets. What are they? Are they the future? Are they the past? Are they good news? Are they bad news? I've got a brilliant expert panel to address these questions. They're each going to speak for a few minutes and then some discussion. And as I think, as Florence mentioned, if you have some questions, please do submit them via the chat box and join the conversation. So I'm delighted to kick off with Monsieur Olivier Fliche, who's from the French supervisor, French regulator. He leads a lot of the work on digital payments, digital assets, digital supervision, and the floor is yours, Olivier.
Thank you, Philip. Maybe to start this panel, I would like to say a few words on two basic questions. Is there a need to regulate crypto assets? Why do we need to regulate crypto assets? And if the answer is yes, how should we regulate? How can we regulate crypto assets? Well, the first question, is there a need to regulate crypto assets? I think, Philip, you mentioned recent press release by the Bank of England, but so I think the consensus is now that we should do something to regulate crypto assets. And the first reason is that the phenomenon is gaining momentum and the mechanisms at stake are very close to the financial sector mechanism. So there is a risk of arbitrage. And so that's the first reason that why we need to regulate crypto assets. Second reason is because there are risks, risk for the consumer or the investor. I will not elaborate on this, but the high volatility of Bitcoins the last month is a case in point. There are risk of money laundering, financing, criminal activities. Here too, there are so many examples that I think I don't need to elaborate. And potentially, there may be risk, or some crypto assets could pose risk to the financial system as a whole. And I think Deputy Governor Dinibo mentioned this risk in his introduction. So here again, I think I don't need to elaborate on this. There is a third and final reason, in my opinion, which is less often mentioned, is that the lack of regulation could be seen as a form of barrier to entry. Lack of regulation is a barrier to entry for some economic players, actors, because a regulatory framework reduces legal uncertainty for many players. It gives visibility and encourage the development of a larger and more reliable ecosystem, longer top business models, and so on. So that's an additional reason. And lack of regulation is, of course, also a handicap for consumers. And consumers are not specialists in cryptography and blockchain. And the fact that blockchain can be public does not guarantee them against the traditional risk of price manipulation, misunderstanding of the risk, and so on. So regulating is also providing consumer with a minimum level of protection. So in short, if I want to be to conclude this part, is we think that regulation can foster, in a way, innovation, and that's also a reason for regulating crypto assets. The second point I would like to address is how should we regulate, how can we regulate? And here would like just to mention two or three very basic principles, but I think they are really necessary when you try to address this issue. Is first, we have to strike the right balance between innovation and regulation. We want that innovation is safe and secure, but of course, it's not the objective to stifle it. We don't want to stifle it. Second, we need to prevent the risk of regulatory arbitrage. We usually sum up this principle as same activity, same risk, same rules. And third, and that's an important principle as well, is proportionality. We need to regulate what needs to be regulated, and we need to be proportionate to the risk when we regulate. So maybe to illustrate this principle, I would like to say a word of what we did of the practice, what we did in France, and what is the project in Europe with the MiCA draft regulation. Well, first, the example of the French example in 2019, we had a law which is called PACT, the PACT Act, which provided a first regulatory framework for digital assets, as well as issuance of utility token in France. Well, I won't elaborate because this framework will be largely replaced by the European regulatory framework. But the point I would like to make is that this regulation has, I think, given France a head start, and that's in itself is a good thing. The MiCA draft regulation so will complement and strengthen our current French framework. It will address the need to establish, of course, a harmonized European legal framework, which is a good thing for a market like Europe. It will also clarify that all regulation for securities, the MiFID directive, will apply to financial assets issued on a distributed ledger. So that's the point about regulatory arbitrage. It will provide a legal framework for what we call stable coins and will create two categories of stable coins. And for one of them, the electronic money tokens, the category which looks like what we call electronic money in Europe, the regulatory regime will be modeled on the electronic money issuers regime. So there again, as I mentioned earlier, we try to reduce the risk of regulatory arbitrage. So I would say MiCA, which is now under discussion, so it's not final text, will be probably a very comprehensive project and will cover a lot of issues. However, I would like to say that we regulators need to be aware of different things. First, a regulation is not the end of the story. And second, we have all other challenges when we try to regulate crypto assets. So first, I would say, in my mind, regulating crypto assets is a moving target. And aiming for a moving target requires increased skill and agility and a sort of modesty, I would say. Business models change very fast. So what may be true today maybe will not be sufficient in 2 years' time. So regulation may become obsolete. And to avoid this risk, we really need to follow the clear principles I mentioned, proportionality, reducing regulatory arbitrage, and having the right balance between risk and regulation. And we must be able to anticipate. And in order to anticipate, I think we must be able to experiment as well. And this is the idea that the European Commission has proposed with a so-called pilot regime, where I think that's the first time, at least in the European regulation, that there is a proposal to test the use of DLT for market infrastructure. So that's something which is new, and I think this approach is very interesting for future regulation. I would like to finish with a few other comments about the important questions which lie ahead of us. Because for the time being, some issues remain outside the scope of regulation. First, decentralized finance, which is developing now. And my question there, I just have the question, I don't have the answer, is what is that potential for development? And if the potential development is high, is there a need to regulate them? In addition, I think we may have to deepen the governance issues of blockchains. So not only crypto assets, but the question of governance of blockchains. Of course, you know that governance is a key principle of financial regulation, and the distributed technology address the governance issue in a very, very original way. We organized a seminar on these issues in January with academics, and it appeared that the blockchain operating rules are not are only a part of the answer to the question raised or posed by a supervisor about governance issue. So this is clearly a subject we need to dig into in the future. And last but not least, there is a final question for a supervisor regulator is, should we remain a mere observer of the development of innovations, or should we become a player in market developments? For example, by encouraging developments of innovation that are useful for the supervision or for the reliability of infrastructure. The Banque de France has already provided some of part of the answer by launching experiments with the digital currency. And as Denibo mentioned in his introduction, we supervisors can do the same thing by talking and experimenting with industry players. So to conclude, I think this is an important approach, and this is very important that we share this among, of course, supervisors, because crypto assets are a cross-border phenomenon. And so international cooperation in this field will be a key factor for the efficiency of a future regulation. Thank you, Philippe. I hope I was not too long.
We could have listened to you, Olivier, for an awful lot longer. Thank you. And of course, you're right, the Banque de France is making important strides here. I mean, scarcely a week goes by without you announcing yet another innovative project, Jura, last week, which clearly we'll talk about it at some other stage. And I think the Banque de France has a very interesting decision about, are you going to be a player, a spectator, or a referee, or indeed three simultaneously. One thing I do find interesting that you raise is Europe is enormously well advanced in thinking about regulation of this without really having much of a market, whereas on the other side of the Atlantic, we have a massive market, and I would suggest perhaps less regulation or less clarity about regulation. And there seem to be about 8 different regulators. And I'm very glad that our next speaker is one of them, Matt Homer, Executive Deputy Superintendent from the New York Financial Regulator Department. Delighted to have you with us, Matt. I hope you can kick off by letting us know what are these assets and who and what should we be seeking to regulate. Over to you, Matt.
Hey, Philip, thank you very much. And thank you to the Banque de France for the opportunity to be here today. I will respond to those questions, but I thought I would comment on, well, first, as you pointed out, I'm at the New York State Department of Financial Services, which has been regulating this space since 2015. And so my remarks will really speak from the New York experience and then the experience of the United States more broadly. And I think what I'd like to do is touch on 3 areas. So I'd like to touch on where we are at now. I'd like to touch on the role I think regulation has played here in New York and the United States. And then I'd like to touch on a few points about where things are headed and what regulators are thinking about or might want to be thinking about as the space moves forward. So in terms of where we're at now, I think that it's a really an interesting time to be, talking about this space, because I think we're at a real inflection point, at least here in the United States. And I think we're at an inflection point with regard to consumers, with regard to financial institutions, and with regard to government and regulators. And starting with consumers, I would argue that in the last 2 years, we have hit a really important point in the market where the majority of US households now have access to crypto assets with apps or services they already have, right? So it used to be that if you were a consumer and you wanted to engage in this market, you would need to seek out a crypto specific platform to purchase a crypto asset or otherwise engage in the market. And that's no longer the case, because we are seeing established financial institutions, banks and others enter the market. And we are also seeing non-crypto specific fintech players, so payment apps and other types of apps enter the space. So if you are an American consumer with a smartphone, there's a very good chance that on your smartphone is an app that will allow you to purchase a crypto asset very, very quickly. And so the availability of these assets is now very, very widespread in the United States. Secondly, as I mentioned, financial institutions, and I touched on this a bit, but we are seeing, a number of financial institutions, established banks and other players enter the space because their customers are demanding it. And those customers include retail customers, but also institutional customers. And I think that, you're seeing use on the institutional side, you're seeing use cases beyond just holding crypto assets, but also, for example, using stable coins, for instantaneous settlement with regard to cross-border payments. So that's a very key development in the last 2 years is established players entering the space. And then the third point I would highlight with regard to illustrating why I think we're at an inflection point is the role of government and regulators. I think a decade ago, government and regulators, it varied, but I think generally, right, it was people saw this space as a curiosity and something that was sort of interesting to maybe monitor or follow. And then maybe 5 years ago, people started wondering, well, do I really need to take this seriously or not? I think that has changed in the last 2 years, where there's a recognition from governments and regulators that this is a space that is not going to go away, and it's a space that requires attention and consideration. And so I think that's a very important development in the market as well. So I think that's sort of where we're at. And then I think just looking back a little bit again, thinking from the experience here in New York about the role of regulation, I'll just provide by way of background, I think to some of your comments, Philip, a little bit of background on the way that the regulatory framework here in the United States. So most here in the US, most crypto specific platforms receive their charter or their license from a state, from one state or from multiple states. And the approach varies from state to state. And it depends on the type of activities a company is engaged in or the business model of a company. But oftentimes in many states, crypto exchanges, for example, are licensed as a form of money transmission, as a money transmitter. But as the space evolves and as new activities become more common, I think we'll see institutions obtaining additional forms of licenses or licenses that allow for a broader form of activities, including lending, for example, which is something that we've seen the market, a development in the market in the last year or so. So states tend to be the licensing or chartering authority and provide the holistic sort of prudential supervision of an entity. But federal authorities, of course, are very deeply involved as well. If there's a token that may or may not may be a security, that of course the SEC is implicated, the CFTC is implicated as it relates to commodities law, specifically in the context of derivatives and futures, and FinCEN, of course, is involved as it relates to the risk of illicit financing, and is the banking sector, the traditional banking sector gets involved. Other federal regulators are getting involved as well. The FDIC here recently released an RFI, a request for information, on digital assets, and I think every federal regulator is involved and looking at the space. So there are true to kind of the dual banking system that exists within the United States, there are a number of regulators that are involved in the supervising and licensing of the space. So New York specifically, I'll just touch a little bit on kind of our experience. As I mentioned a few moments ago, New York is one of the first states and first regulators, I think, anywhere to enter the space. We promulgated our rules in 2015. Those rules focus on virtual currency business activity, and there are five areas of activity that are identified, and that includes custodians, it includes exchanges, it includes issuers. It's pretty broad and covers many different activities within the crypto asset space. And you know, if I think about the role that regulation has had in the space, I think you know early on there was a lot of. I was not a DFS at the time, but I remember you know just from the news and from kind of the chatter in the industry, there was a lot of gnashing of teeth and there was a lot of frustration. You know, with regard to our regulatory framework. And, you know, but I think that over the past 6 years now, you know, the fact that New York has had a regulated environment for crypto has really supported the maturation of the industry. I think the industry has matured and become mainstream in a way that would not have been possible were it not for, you know, for our regulatory environment. I think that speaks to Olivier's point, actually, one of his points. And you know, we've now granted 30 licensors or charters over the past 6 years, and we have a steady stream of additional applicants. And you know, I mean, to the point, and I think that the companies that have embraced regulation have really done well. And we even see some of the companies that we have licensed include the fact that they are regulated in their you know, in their subway advertisements and other types of promotions, bragging about being a regulated crypto exchange. But I do think, and I'll talk about this in a few moments. I do think that you know, regulating the space is challenging. I mean, it's constant, as Olivier pointed out. I mean, it's constantly adapting. It's constantly moving, and it really requires, I think, a different type of approach, one that is much more iterative, one that involves continuous ongoing dialogue with the industry. So in terms of you know where things are headed, what the horizon looks like, and you know, particularly with a regulatory lens, I mean, I think that there will continue to be ups and downs. There is volatility in this market, as we've discussed. But I also expect that the market will continue to integrate with the mainstream financial system. We'll continue to see those integrations occur. And you know, that will change the crypto industry. It will also change the traditional financial system as well. And individual tokens, you know, I think will come and go, but I think the underlying infrastructure that's being built to support those digital assets, to me, that's what's kind of the most interesting about this space. And I think that underlying new infrastructure has the potential to be very substantial for finance more broadly. I'll just highlight, you know, as I sort of conclude my remarks here, a few risks that I think are emerging. So I think all of the risks that have been identified thus far are very, you know, important. I think cyber, you know, will continue to be a very important risk, one of the most important risks, particularly for, you know, with regard to the custody, right, of these assets. I think, you know, it'll be interesting to see how the insurance sector responds and what, you know, I think that there will be a very important role for the insurance sector in this space. There will continue to be important risks related to illicit financing, which tend to get you know the most attention, but I think is you know just one risk of several. But I think one risk that you know we will as regulators increasingly need to focus on is consumer protection. I think up until now this has been sort of a hobbyist space. It's been a space for early adopters. It's been a space that you know I think. People have not been as focused on from a consumer protection perspective because I think there's sort of an assumption that it was you know just sort of you know people who knew what they were doing who were engaged in the space, and that really I think is changing, and I think it will require probably a completely new type of consumer protection framework. I think it would probably be a mistake to apply you know kind of a legacy consumer protection framework to this new area. I think it you know it probably requires something that is built from or sewn from new cloth for this specific asset class. And you know, if I think about the role of regulators and again, you know, here in New York in kind of keeping up with all this, as I said, it's a rapidly evolving space, and I think that, you know, regulators generally, you know, want to support innovation around these issues. And I think the key challenge for regulators is figuring out, you know, what is the right moment to step in and regulate, right? And I think you can regulate too soon, you can regulate too late. So what is the right moment to step in? And then how do you continue to iterate? How do you continue to kind of build your framework, adapt your framework as you go along? I think with that, I will pause. Thank you, Philip.
Thank you very much indeed, Matt. And I have two big themes now coming through. One, when we seem to believe that crypto assets, however we define them, are growing, are important, and are here to stay. They're not going to be stopped, so therefore they either have to be lived with or dealt with. Secondly, we feel that greatly expanded regulation, it channels this innovation, this new markets into the right areas and prevents a number of risks to financial stability. I think the whole consumer protection question you just raised is a particularly important one. So a booming industry for regulators. Interesting questions about mutual recognition and so forth. And the potential expansion in the powers of regulators to non-financial players altogether. Who is going to regulate a crypto exchange, for example? So therefore, also a lot more work for lawyers. And our next speaker is a very distinguished lawyer. Hubert de Vauplane is a partner in Kramer-Levin, distinguished American European firm of lawyers. He speaks to us from Paris, and the particular emphasis on some of the legal challenges that are emerging. So over to you, Hubert.
Thank you, Philippe. Thank you for inviting me to attend to this seminar. What I'd like to do is to make such kind of comparison between EU and the US in terms of regulation. And how do the EU and the US plan to regulate the crypto asset markets? Is there any regulatory strategy? What are the differences in terms of methodology between the US and the EU when it comes to regulating crypto assets? As you know, I am not a US expert on regulation. I am just a simple observer. And please apologize for any misinterpretation for the US regulation, specifically Matt. I'd like to make four remarks. The first remark, as for Olivier, should we regulate for sure? In the EU, the answer is yes. The EU is proposing a very precise regulation project that frames the activities on crypto assets and the intermediaries on crypto assets. It is a strong regulatory choice consisting in duplicating more or less the mode of regulation of the financial markets to the world of the crypto assets. The MiCA project is largely inspired by the EU law, in particular the MiFID directive, but also by the French law with the PACT law. It is about transposing, if I may, the mode of regulation of financial markets and financial instruments to the case of crypto assets. For the observers that I am, it seems that at this stage, this is not the case of at least the methodology which is followed in the US. Second remark, the competencies in terms of regulation. The competence seems to be quite different between the EU and the US. Europe considers that the subject of crypto regulation is the exclusive competence of the EU law and not of the member states. The result is not a framework in the form of a directive, but in the form of a regulation directly applicable to the 27 member states without any need with local implementation. Choose. There will be only one applicable law in Europe regarding crypto asset activities. In the US, the question arises as to whether the regulatory competence is federal or state. Look at the discussion with Matt. This of course depends on the qualification of crypto assets. If crypto assets are qualified as securities or commodities, the federal jurisdiction of the SEC or CFTC will be applicable. Third remark, the legal qualification of crypto assets. Europe, like France, but other countries, has chosen to define crypto assets in a particular and specific way. This is a new definition. A crypto asset is used legally far as totally different from a security or a commodity. This is legally something different. In other words, the regulation applicable to crypto assets is distinct from the regulation applicable to securities and derivatives. This is the reason why the EU proposed the creation of a new status of crypto asset service providers with a specific licensing regime. In the US, it seems to me that the situation is different. First, and from an outside observer, the role of the SEC seems to be predominant among the various federal regulators. In this respect, it seems that the SEC tends to qualify a number of use cases or projects related to crypto assets as securities, in the sense of the Supreme Court Howe test. For example, when the SEC filed against Ripple Labs and two of its executives. Similarly, the CFTC appears to consider certain cases as falling under the Commodity Act. See the civil enforcement action by the CFTC accusing BitMEX and Binance of operating an unregistered trading platform selling crypto derivatives. Treasury views crypto from the perspective of currencies. FinCEN has its own view on definition on crypto. It seems to see maybe not a battle, but something like a battle in the coming months between US regulators to know which one has the most power in the future regulation. For example, see the quite recent statement a few days ago from the OCC, the Fed, and the FDIC to join their views on crypto regulation. All of this shows for a foreign observer as a mosaic or a puzzle with a certain kind of heterogeneity of definitions. Fourth remark. Do these differences have an impact on the financial innovation? And specifically in terms of methodology between EU and the US? See the case of stablecoins. It is interesting to note that the difference between Europe and the US regarding stablecoins, and in particular global stablecoins. Europe has been very critical about Libra project, as you know, which became Diem. Several statements from the French and the German finance ministers in particular have shown their opposition to this project. The objective was very clearly expressed at this time. Europe wants to keep monetary sovereignty over the euro and will not accept unregulated euro stablecoins. This is a question of monetary sovereignty. As a result, the MiCA project, the regulation of stablecoin will be very restrictive, obliging issuers to apply for a regulated status such as of a bank or credit institution, or for stablecoins linked to non-monetary assets for very strict procedural and process commitments. This is quite curious as most of the stablecoins are pegged on the US dollar and not in the euro. Why having such regulation when the large majority of stablecoins are pegged on dollar and not in euro? If you look about the US, the publication in this year, in January 2021, of an interpretative letter from the OCC authorizing federal banks to use stablecoins is significant in this regard, in the light of the reluctance expressed in Europe by EBA, European Banking Authority. In conclusion, what should be remembered? Europe regulates a market that is not essentially not localized in Europe. To tell you differently, Europe regulates something which doesn't exist in Europe. The main players in crypto are American or Asian, even British, but not European. Trading volumes are largely localized in Asia and in the US, and a little in Europe. Choose. Even though the regulatory situation in the US regarding crypto is not always very clear and predictable due to the multiple regulators, the situation does not prevent innovation and market growth in the US. This is the opposite situation in Europe. Should we conclude that we should not regulate too quickly? Yes, this is my opinion. Thank you, Philippe.
Thank you very much, Hubert. In the interest of time, I'm going to pass straight over to our final panelist in this session, who is author, advisor, commentator, all-around global expert and agent provocateur on all things to do with digital payments. Lots to unpack here, Dave. I'll let you go where the piece takes you. So over to Dave Birch. Who's on mute currently?
Yeah, I've only had 18 months to practice this. It's not surprising I got it wrong. So roughly how long do you want me to run for, Philip? I have a standard 14-hour presentation about this. Or you want me to cut it down a little bit?
Thank you, General Castro. 8 minutes, please.
Okay, so I just want to suggest to the panel and obviously test their responses on that. I think we have a very underdeveloped view of what this new digital financial services landscape will be. And as a consequence, and I agree very much with the point just made that we mustn't rush to regulate this. But my point is, we need rather a lot of regulation. And we're going to need it in some pretty interesting areas, which it's not clear to me that people are thinking about at the moment. So let me just try and explain to you why I think that is. If we're talking about crypto, I'm going to use the word tokens just to save time from now on. So we're talking about crypto assets that can be moved from one owner to another without the intermediation of any kind of institution. In other words, if I sell Philip some IBM stock, that involves brokers and dealers and market makers and delivery versus payment and settlement and back offices and all sorts of other things. But if I send Philip some IBM money, for want of a better word, it goes from my wallet to his wallet and there are no intermediaries and there is no settlement. And that's why the money men, never mind technologists, that's why the money men want tokenization, because they see it correctly, in my opinion, as a lower cost market. And we all share the same goal for the next generation of digital financial services of reducing the costs of financial intermediation, which have remained stubbornly high. So I agree with the principle. I agree with what people are trying to do. If we have tokens which can move without the mediation of institutions, that opens up the basic structure of the next generation of financial services. And what I mean by that is whatever those tokens are, and you know, we can temporarily divide them into sort of two categories. We have the sort of non-fungible tokens, which are going to be used for, you know, event ticketing and all sorts of things like that. There's two categories of non-fungible tokens. Obviously, there are useful non-fungible tokens, which will be, for example, tickets to get you into a Euro football game this evening, or something else. And there are useless non-fungible things, which we for historical reasons, we call this art. And I don't really want to cover those more in this area. But amongst the fungible tokens, let's not call them money, but let's just say in certain circumstances, they can function as money-like instruments, which is what the finance guys want. We can divide them between those whose value is maintained essentially on the blockchain. It almost certainly won't be a blockchain, but let's call it a blockchain for sake of argument, or those whose value is maintained off of it using some sort of institutional binding, which would obviously be regulated. We already understand what one category of that is, because if we want to bind it to existing fiat currencies, we essentially already have the electronic money institution as a mechanism for doing that. If we're going to bind it to something else, an ounce of gold or a square inch of the Mona Lisa, or, you know, a foot of an office building somewhere, We can, I imagine, do that under private contract law, and the lawyers may obviously, well, no, they won't. They won't say yes or no. They'll say it depends, because that's what lawyers always say, because that's their business model. But I'm assuming the point is this can all be taken care of. So now we have these tokens that can move from place to place. And one of the ways that we can move them without intermediation is through the use of what people hilariously and incorrectly keep referring to as smart, they're not smart, contracts, they're not contracts, but what normal people such as me call apps. So now we have some apps that can move these tokens around from place to place, that intermediation. And the issue of whether the providers of those apps have some sort of fiduciary responsibility seems to me to be absolutely critical to where we want to go. We don't want to use the blockchain and tokens and cryptography and digital signatures and all those other things to build costly, slow, pointless emulations, infrastructure that you already have. And this is why most blockchain projects say, you know, when people explain them to you, they sound stupid, because they're using the blockchain to try and emulate an Oracle database. Well, what's the point? We already have an Oracle database. We don't need a blockchain to pretend to be a data. What we want is to do things in a new way that reduces costs, and also, by the way, acts as a platform for innovation and invention and new products and services. And we can't do that. So therefore, those apps must have some kind of regulation around them. Whether they're regulated, I can't say what that should be, but it doesn't seem right that anybody can just write an app. The idea of using these in this, in what people call the decentralized finance marketplace, the idea of using these apps as what as money Lego, I completely agree with that, right? But I don't want a Lego brick that I'm going to plug into my new financial services product, which turns out to be an unexploded bomb. And you know, when you press the button, it kills everybody. So therefore, there has to be some form of regulation of what these apps are. My personal opinion is that we might end up with a certification infrastructure where you're only allowed to use Money Lego, which has been certified in some way by someone who will assess, you know, some kind of fiduciary duty. Why do I think that's such a big deal? Because I think when you plug those money Legos together, and in fact, you can already see this in the DeFi markets right now. I'm quite an intelligent person, right? And I try and read some of these DeFi contracts. I have no clue what they're doing. I said, what's the idea? And the guy said, well, what we're going to do is we're going to borrow some money using this contract, and then we're going to stake it using that contract. And then we're going to use this Oracle. And then when it flips, we're going to lend the money through that contract and pull it back under. I have no clue what they're talking about, and nor does anybody else. How you're going to regulate that, I'm no idea. And the reason is the next generation financial services products that are going to be built from those money Legos are not going to be built by people, and they're not going to be built for people. Those are products that will be built by robots, and they're for robots. And so therefore there has to be, and that's how we will get better financial intermediation, and that's how we'll get a cheaper infrastructure, and that's how we'll get more sophisticated products and services. No one's going to put those money Legos together to explain to me how it all works. They're going to put that money Lego together because the bank robot is going to sell it to my robot. And I want the greediest, most mercenary, rent seeking robot available to man, and if Google or anybody else will give it to me, then I will set that robot free to maximize my financial returns. You're talking about products which will be by robots and for robots, and so there must be some link with the emergent field of AI regulation where the commission has already made some interesting proposals. One of which, by the way, is to stop doing anything for a while until we can figure out what on earth is going on, which may well be, you know, one of the best ways forward. So in summary,
I'm afraid, Dave, the moderator robot has to call the speaker robot to address at the moment, because unfortunately we've run out of time. Thank you to all members of the panel. Please stick around for the next section, which is going to start in precisely 1 minute. But we'll get a pause during which you can have a look at Banque de France's new New York office building. Thank you to everybody. See you in a minute.